Well, good morning, Harvest. It is good to be in the house. Your cousin from down south is coming to visit. And I'm looking forward to getting into God's word today. But before we get into God's word, we need to have one order of business that we need to do. I want to give a shout out. We don't do shout outs at Harvest Bible Chapel, but if we did, I want to give a shout out to all the volunteers and the staff at this campus that make things happen every week. Oh, y'all can do better than that. This is your family on the cameras and in the back. Thank you guys so much. It's amazing when you come to church. I think sometimes people just feel like it just happens. You know, just ants come out and start getting on the cameras and behind the scenes. But it's amazing the laughter that we share and people that pray for us every week. So thank you so much for that. I have a very difficult assignment because I have to preach the word and encourage God's people. That's the first thing. But the second thing is I want to say a very special welcome to those in the room and those that are online that maybe you're far from Christ and you just came because someone lied to you and said you were going to lunch and they took a detour and ended up at a church. I just want to say thank you so much for being here, and I'm so glad that you're with us. But there's a third a person that I need to speak to very clearly. It's to the enemy. It's to Satan, to let him know that you have no right to be in this place, and I cancel the assignment that you have in the lives of God's people. And so when you come, a lot of things happen when people preach the word. People are checking Facebook and getting their reservations for lunch. But there's something that's important. When we come to God's word, we want to hear with clarity. And so I want to ask the Lord to be with me as I preach this morning. And so if you would bow your heads with me as we go to the Lord in prayer. Father, thank you so much for the opportunity to share your word. Thank you for every person, every man, every woman, every boy and girl that is here and joining us online. We pray for clarity. We pray for humility, Lord, before the word. I ask for forgiveness of sin in my life that would keep clarity of the word from going forth. I beg you, Lord, for your anointing in this moment to be able to communicate the word of God. And we ask it in the matchless name of Jesus. More of you and less of me. And it's in your name we pray. Amen. Well, I'm ready to go to work. Open your Bibles. 2 Samuel chapter 9 is where we are this weekend. And there's a few things that I want to share with you out of this passage as we talk about the kindness of God. The kindness of God. In the 1980s, there was a television show that many of the baby boomers in the room probably remember. Some of us were too young or maybe not allowed to see this show, but it's funny how television helps explore what friendship is like. It took place in a bar in the Northeast, and it had some colorful characters, and Norm was one of my favorites, and it was really interesting. They called it Cheers. Anybody remember that show? Yeah, you're too young to know about that. But Cheers was a show that was on, and it was very interesting. In the song that they had a song that just caught fire, that everybody wants to go where everyone knows their name, and everybody wants to know where they're glad that what? That they came. Yeah, friendship is amazing. But I'm a 90s baby, hip-hop, and there was a show that we're going to celebrate next month all around the world. It's amazing, this group of good-looking young adults in New York City in an apartment. I've never seen that many white people in an apartment in my life. I was like, don't they have any friends that are other than... But, you know, it was a show called Friends. And 25 years, can you believe that? I know some of you guys are looking at me thinking I'm 32, and I appreciate that. But Friends came out when I was in college, and it was interesting. They had a theme song that caught fire. And the line that everyone remembered is, I'll be there for you. I'll be there for you. Something about friendship, being there. But I have to be honest with you. I haven't watched probably 5 full episodes of Friends in my life. Because where I grew up, there was another show about friends that lived in an apartment that we watched. And maybe some of you know about this show. It's the same time frame. It was called Martin. At Rolling Meadows, I see you. I know that you were cultured, but we watched Martin, and Martin had some interesting characters that talked about life as well, and they did life together because it's better to be connected in life. Well, Ed, what do those three shows have to do with me? No, I didn't leave you out, millennials, because I was told last night that millennials are watching Friends. I can't believe it, what is old has become new again. Whether you're streaming or whether you're remembering, friendship matters. 98% of the population, research tells us, has at least one or two friends that they would consider a good friend. The average is that you have nine friends that you would call close. Jesus, that outkicked his coverage. He had three, Peter, James, and John. He did life with 12. So parenthetically, I just want to give you something free. It's not even in my notes. Some of you need to be released, maybe about 50 of you in this room, to know everybody is not your friend. I just hope that just released somebody right there, that everybody's not your friend. Stop trying to be friends with everybody. Loving people doesn't mean that they're your friend. But I think there's something important to know about the text today. It's all about friendship. But if you're going to understand 2 Samuel 9, you need to write in your notes 1 Samuel 18 through 20. 1 Samuel chapter 18 through 20. I'm giving you a little cliff note. I'm giving you an urban cliff note of what happened in 18 through 20. So there was an original OG. His name was Saul. And Saul was the first king. Oh, I'm sorry. Original gangster is what that stands for those that don't know. Saul was not a good guy. He had an anger problem, and he liked to kill people. He had a few kids, and one of his sons, his name was Jonathan. We'll just call him Jay. So Jay was pretty cool, handsome brother, was in the military. He had some friends, but one friend was really close. His name was David. David was a friend from the other side of the tracks, you see, because David actually grew up a shepherd boy. He was handsome, the Bible said, ladies, keep a check. So you got two handsome brothers, they became friends, they're from other sides of the track. And in chapter 18, we see the closeness of their friendship. But something happens in chapter 19. Mess happens. See, the original gangster, the OG, Saul, decides, I want to go after David because he's anointed. God's hand is on his life. And oh my goodness, it looks like he's going to be the next king. We can't let that happen because this is my kingdom. So I want to go after and kill him. But the OG, Saul, finds out that his son is good best friends with David. So he curses his son. Somebody just look at your neighbor and say, it's complicated. It's complicated. Sometimes family is complicated. And I know some of you have Norman Rockwell families, but I came from the E! True Hollywood side of the road. And family can be a little dramatic at times. And so Jonathan does something in chapter 19. He warns David that he's getting ready to be killed. You got to get out of here. You got to go get some. In fact, meet me in chapter 20 in the field. I got a plan. It's all good. You just got to meet me. So he ends up meeting him in chapter 20, and they end up doing something that changes their lives forever. They make a covenant with each other, and Jonathan asks one thing really simple. I want you to honor this commitment before God and man that you'll remember my family. If I'm gone, that you're going to remember him. We're ride or die brothers for the rest of our life. How many of you love friends that just are with you through thick and thin? You know, not the ones that are with you when you have a bank account and your car is running, but the ones that when you're broke, you're so broke and poor, you're just po, you can't even afford the R. That's the person that I'm talking about, that Jonathan and David were together. And Jonathan said, I want you to never forget this moment. And the Bible says that they embraced each other at the end of chapter 20 and wept. And the author lets us know that David wept even louder because he was sad to leave his boy Jonathan. Ladies, beware of a man that can't cry. Be very, very afraid. Real men cry. This is nothing that was soft about these two brothers. They were friends. They were tight. So I want to ask you this question as we get into the text today. What does it mean to be a real friend? What does it mean to be a real friend? In a day where we can just cancel people and delete and unfriend, what does it really mean for us to be a friend? Well, thank you. I'm glad you asked. I have a few things that I want to share about that. There's six things about a godly friendship that we should know about before we get into the text today. I love how Becky Sweat brings this out. Something I was reading this last week. Here's six characteristics of a biblical friendship. The first two are from the same verse. Number one, unconditional love. Unconditional love, amen. I love that I'm in a place that y'all love to talk to a pastor. Unconditional love, I like to be with people who fully know me and still love me. Not people who withhold their love, but people who are unconditional in their love. The Bible says in Proverbs 17:17 that a friend loves at all times, and a brother is built and made for adversity. It gets to number two, support during trials. Support during trials. I've been at Harvest Bible Chapel a little over 2 years. It's been a rather calm 2 years, rather uneventful. And I just want you to know that some of the people who were singing on the stage and some of the people who have been serving you throughout this season are the very people who have supported me in the midst of the last season that we've been in. It's just amazing when you see brothers and sisters who are built for adversity. They give you support and you relax, you exhale when you're in their presence. You don't have to be something that you're not, you just can be. Anybody love a friend like that? That's what David and Jonathan had. But the third thing that true friendship, genuine happiness about each other's success. Genuine happiness about each other's success. Romans 12, verse 15 talks about rejoicing with those who rejoice and weeping with those who weep. And I just want to park it right here just for a moment. Any of you have a friend that when you share good news about your life, they immediately start sharing about their life? Keep looking this way. Don't give away the person next to you. But have you ever had that person? I'm trying to share something good about my life, and then you throw shade. Look, we just got pregnant. Oh my goodness, we're having twins. Can we celebrate our birth? Can we celebrate that we got a house? Can we celebrate that we got a job? Just genuinely be supportive of my good season. I know that doesn't happen at Rolling Meadows, but sometimes in the city we get caught up. Number four, edifying conversations. Edifying conversations. It's not always about drama and mess. Just edifying, just encouraging. One of my boys came in town, and he was taking his parents and his oldest son to go on vacation. He lives in Madison, Wisconsin. He called me 24 hours ago and said, Ed, I'm going to the airport. I'm going to be at Midway. I know that you're preaching. I just want to have a late breakfast with you and check in and see how you're doing. Conversation was just so edifying after we had gained 3,000 calories together and just enjoyed the fellowship. It was just edifying. It set the tone for the rest of the day. But number five is something that we wrestle with in our culture. Gentle correction. Gentle correction. We've been in a season where gentle correction has been necessary. And the word gentle is there intentional, because some of y'all don't know how to do it. I mean, gentle correction is something that's loving. You just, Kyle, we just, thank you so much. I said too much there. I'm going to correct that. I'm asking for forgiveness. It's not brutal and harsh. It's gentle. A kind word turns away. But the last thing that a biblical friendship has. It is time together. You can't cultivate a friendship and not be together. I saw a couple Instagram posts this last week that just blessed my heart. I love when I see brothers get together and ladies get together for their little weekends. And you get together and it's called, we don't talk about what happened, but we will post the picture to let you know we had a good time. Anybody ever been on those trips? We've been together. You don't need to know what happened. It's not that kind of party. But we are together because we don't have to communicate things that we don't have to say. We just know and we're together and we spend good time together. Something happens when you spend time together. And I believe that David was thinking about his friend as we come to chapter 9. We'll read the first 5 verses. Look along with me. If you don't have a Bible, one's been provided for you. You can take your neighbor's. That's fine as well. Just give it to them after service. But I want to get into the Word of God in 2 Samuel chapter 9. And David said, "Is there still anyone left in the house of Saul that I may show him kindness for Jonathan's sake?" Now there was a servant of the house of Saul whose name was Ziba. And they called him to David. And the king said to him, "Are you Ziba?" And he said, "I am your servant." And the king said, "Is there not still someone in the house of Saul that I may show the kindness of God to him?" And Ziba said to the king, "There is still a son of Jonathan. He is crippled in his feet." The king said to him, "Where is he?" And Ziba said to the king, "He is in the house of Machir, the son of Amiel, at Lodibar." And the Bible says in verse 5, then King David sent and brought for him from the house of Machir, the son of Amiel, at Lodibar. The first thing I want to share with you today is that the kindness of God is available to me no matter where I am. The kindness of God is available to me no matter where I am. Look at verse 1 because it's going to unpack and set the tone for the entire sermon. We see here in chapters 1 through 8 that David has consolidated power, and his first order of business is he's handling his business. There's something that is outstanding that he remembers that he needs to do. And he asks his officials, "Is there anyone in the house of Saul left that I could share the kindness of God on behalf of Jonathan?" Now, I just shared with you guys the cliff notes of the story. Is it not interesting that David longs to show kindness to the house of somebody who tried to kill him? I know y'all might be a little more holy up here in Rolling Meadows, but in the city, we don't roll like that. We don't think that, oh my goodness, what we should do is show kindness to somebody who hates me. But in the kingdom of God, we do things differently, don't we? Matthew 5:44 and 1 Peter 3:9 tell us that we shouldn't return evil with evil. We don't revile people who revile us. But the Bible says that we are to bless our enemies. I got 2 amens on that in the house. It's amazing. There was no shouting that was going on that. But the Bible says that we're to bless people who are our enemies. I want to double dog dare you to do something over the next month. All of you, under the sound of my voice, I want you for the next month, every time that somebody persecutes you or dogs you out, I want you to kill them with kindness. You're at work, they threw you under the bus in the project, you knew you did the work, and your boss took credit. I want you to pipe up. "Susan, you did a fantastic job." That project, if you weren't at the helm, Susan, we wouldn't have been able to complete it. You know, maybe it's your spouse who's not following Christ and does something harsh and says something out of character at home, and it hurts your feelings, and immediately, "Baby, I just want to tell you how much I love you. It's a little far at this moment, but I just want you to know I love you." You know, that child that that has been wayward, that you've been praying and weeping for, and they came and asked for more money, but you know that they blew it already on alcohol or maybe drugs or something else, and they come and ask for more money. I want you to bless them and tell them how you see them, not as they are, but as they will be. I don't know what it is about this passage, but I believe that David learned early on that you should bless those who despitefully use you. What about you? When's the last time you prayed and blessed a hater in your life? You're going to have plenty of opportunity the next 30 days. Something happens when found people find people. David himself was found. He was found. He knows what it's like to be a person who is rescued, who's saved, who's protected. When found people find people, the atmosphere changes. What would happen, Rolling Meadows, if we looked for people to love? What would happen if we went out in the community and blessed people today? As you're having lunch, pay the bill for the person who is next to you. As you're going to Starbucks to get that third cup of coffee before 2 o'clock, why don't you just pay for the other person that is in the line? Something happens when found people find people. But it wasn't just that he wanted to bless. There's that little word there, kindness. Kindness. There's never a place so far that God can't reach. There's never a place that God's kindness is so far that it can't reach. And he says, I'm going to show kindness, not on behalf of Saul, not on behalf of his children, but on behalf of a covenant that I made with Jonathan. You know, it's interesting, that word translated kindness is hesed. Hesed means loyalty or joint obligation, faithfulness, goodness. I don't just want to find somebody, I want to bless somebody. I don't want to just find people, I want to lavish goodness on people. And I don't know about you, he just asked a simple question for Ziba to do. He saw Ziba, and Ziba was in Saul's home and one of his servants, and by this point, both Saul and Jonathan are dead. They were killed in battle. So he asked, look what David does, he asked for someone who can solve the problem. And he says, can you go and look and find out if there's anybody else in the house of Saul? Ziba's, oh, Saul, good. So we're going to travel over on the other side of the Jordan. We run into this place that we'll get to in a moment called Lodibar. And he says something that's interesting when he comes back. He says, I have found someone that's alive. It's a son, and he has crippled feet. I don't want to be sarcastic, but I'm just going to step out for a moment of the text and say, did everybody see the question that David said? All he asked was, can you go and find out if somebody's alive? He didn't ask for a DNA test. He didn't say, can you tell me about whether he's crippled or not? I just want to know if somebody is alive so that I can be a blessing. Isn't it interesting in our lives that we have some people who, instead of looking at us for our name and who we are, they want to describe who we are. Oh, yeah, you know, she's a liar. And I asked, did you have a friend? I didn't ask if she was a liar. Oh, well, yeah, he's my trifling husband. He's no good. He always forgets. Every time I tell him to get stuff at the store, he never remembers. I didn't ask you that. I asked, do you have a husband? Ziba, that was the TMI moment. You didn't have to go into all of that. I asked you, is there anybody that's alive? And it would be helpful if you gave me a name. But the Bible doesn't even give us that. It just says that he says that there is a son and he has crippled feet. And I love that the king said, where is he? Go get him. Go bring him here. I want him here in my house. Why was he crippled? You might want to go
in your free time, 2 Samuel chapter 4, verse 4. We find out that a nurse, when he was 5 years old, dropped him, and he became crippled with 2 feet. Now, ladies and gentlemen, I'm not a doctor, but if you drop a baby who's 5 and they end up with crippled feet, I believe that was a rather traumatic fall. I don't think that was, oh my goodness, he just fell right. Something the Bible doesn't let us know, but it was traumatic. It wasn't his fault, but something happened to him that changed his trajectory and changed the rest of his life. Can you relate? Have you ever been dropped and it wasn't your responsibility? Has someone ever left you and you didn't ask to be hurt? Have some of you ever experienced what it feels like to be alone in a place that you don't know what the future is going to be and you didn't have anything to do with it, but you found yourself in that place? Rolling Meadows, can you relate? Do you believe that the Lord may be speaking to us? It wasn't your fault. It wasn't your fault that you were dropped by a nurse and while she was escaping, trying to keep you safe. It wasn't your fault. Somebody needs to know this morning, it wasn't your fault. But you have a responsibility how you respond. It wasn't your fault, but you have a responsibility how you respond. The Bible tells us in verse 5, and I love how it begins to build. Then King David sent and brought him from the house of Machir, the son of Amiel, at Lodabar. God has not forgotten you. Somebody needs to know today that God has not forgotten you. You're not an afterthought in his mind. He doesn't lose track of your story. He knows what you're going through. And in this moment, he finds someone in Lodabar. Lodabar is an actual place, but it's a figurative place as well. Get this, the word Lodabar means pastureless. Pastureless, dry, desolate. Nobody was going on hotels.com to look at a weekend vacation in Lodabar. No one went on Expedia.com to get a resort in Lodabar. But that's where Ziba finds the main character of the story. And I can't believe what it must have been like to be so isolated, so alone, crippled, forgotten, out of sight, without family. It brings us to our second point. God's kindness reaches me regardless of who I am. God's kindness reaches me regardless of who I am. We find out the main character of the story in verse 6. And Mephibosheth, the son of Jonathan, son of Saul, came to David and fell on his face and paid homage. And David said, Mephibosheth. And he answered, behold, I am your servant. And David said to him, do not fear, for I will show you the kindness for the sake of your father Jonathan, and I will restore to you all the land of your father, and you shall eat at my table always. And look at verse 8. And he paid homage and said, what is your servant that you should show regard for a dead dog such as I? Wow. So we find out the name finally. His name is Mephibosheth. I've been in ministry a number of years. I just want to let you all know, I've never met a man whose name is Mephibosheth. I've met a lot of Jonathans, a lot of Davids, met even a few Sauls. Not one, anybody having a baby, it's still available, Mephibosheth. Well, Mephibosheth is kind of interesting. Beside the fact that you don't want to say that too fast, you might get in trouble. His name means scatters shame. Scatters shame.
So here is, get this, the grandson of a king, a son of a prince who's living in Lodabar. I don't want you to miss this. A grandson of a king, a son of a prince who's living in Lodabar. It doesn't make sense. How is royalty in a place of desolation? And David is about to do something that's going to change the trajectory of his life. Because David wants him to know you're living beneath your privilege. You don't know who your daddy is. I could just preach on that right there. You don't know who your daddy is. Your daddy is my best friend. Your daddy was a good man. Your daddy stood for something, and you need to know that you're not called to be in Lodabar. You're called to be in Jerusalem at my table. So he goes and brings him, and I wish that I could act this out the way that I feel it. Because I think that David was just going about his business, probably with some officials, and someone said, hey, king, there's someone at the door for you. I'm a little busy, guys. I'm a little busy right now. Hey, king, there's someone at the door for you. Oh, okay. All right, send him in. Mephibosheth! I bet in that moment he saw Jonathan. I bet in that moment he saw his face. It's like when people see me and it's, oh my goodness, you remind me so much of your daddy. It's just the features of his face. And he's just, Mephibosheth, you're alive. That was so important, y'all. Because culturally, Mephibosheth probably was walking in extremely afraid. Because back in that day, if you were the enemy of the king, if you were not in the house, if you showed up, we were ready to kill you, to silence you, to take you out. But look what the king says, and I love it. He says, fear not, because I will show you, there's that word again, kindness on the sake of your father. Isaiah 41:10, fear not, for I am with you. Be not dismayed, because I'm your God. I believe that somebody under the sound of my voice needs to understand that the Lord wants you not to have fear, that his kindness is on your life. And I love that he has a son himself that we find out a little bit later. His name is Micah. My own son is named Micah. I'm just thinking about this, that Mephibosheth hasn't done anything in this passage. But the king is bestowing love and grace. Have you ever been in that place in your life where you realize there's nothing that you could do but call out to the Lord? There's nothing that you could do but get low. Notice Mephibosheth got low before the king. Now, I'm not a doctor, but the Bible says that he was crippled in 2 feet. But the brother got down low when the king was there, and he bowed down. Harvest, I believe there's something remarkable that's happening in our midst because we've been made to get low before the Lord. It's not nice to get low. I don't like how it feels sometimes to get low. But when you get low, you have the proper perspective that the Lord Jesus is the one who's in control, not you. It's not yours. It's not your house. It's not your stuff. None of it is yours. In fact, there's nothing that you can do without Jesus. So here in this moment, we see him getting low, begging for the mercy of the king. And the king lets him know, you don't have to beg up in this place because you're my son. You don't have to beg for things because what's getting ready to happen is you're getting ready to have everything that you lost restored. Look at your neighbor and said, I want it all back. I want it all back. Everything that was mine, I want it all back. He goes and he says, your daddy's stuff is all yours. I'm giving it to you. And not only that, you're coming to my house. I love that God often takes my private pain and turns it into public promotion.
God can take your private pain and turn it into public promotion. Kelly was a friend of mine, and she went through an abortion, and she never could forgive herself. And she came to our Bible study years ago, and she said, "Ed, I know that God loves me, but I can't forgive myself. I just always hear the baby crying." And I saw everybody in the small group circle around her and love her to life, to let her know your past is not your destiny. Your destiny is who God says that you are. You are loved, you are forgiven, you are his daughter. I don't know who needs to hear today the fact that your circumstances are not what defines you. What defines you is who God says you are. Your circumstances don't define you. What defines you is who God says that you are. And I love the tension in verse 8. It messes me up. I had to wrestle with it because it's culturally appropriate to pay homage to the king. But Mephibosheth goes a little far because he says, "What is your servant to you? I'm a dead dog." You know what's interesting in ministry is I see people who hang out in Lodabar too long, and it changes their sense of identity. They forget who they are. They start to think that they are their sin, and they forget that they are a child of God. And I love in this moment that David didn't dignify even the response. Because look at what happens in the next verse, verse 9. Then the king called Ziba, didn't even pay attention to what he said. He just called Ziba and he said, "Listen, Ziba, Saul's servant, all that belonged to Saul and to all his house I've given to your master's grandson." He's starting to make preparations right here. "And to your son's sons, and your servants shall till the land for him and shall bring in the produce that the master's grandson may have bread to eat." So here you are. He's crippled, and he's making accommodations that he's cared for by servants. But then look at the next verse. "But Mephibosheth, your master's grandson, shall always eat at my table." Oh, that's good news. Now Ziba had 15 sons and 20 servants. Then Ziba said to the king, "According to all that my lord the king commands, the servant, so will your servant do." So Mephibosheth ate at David's table like one of the king's sons. And Mephibosheth had a young son whose name was Micah. And all who lived in the house became Mephibosheth's servants. So Mephibosheth lived in Jerusalem, for he ate always at the king's table. Now he was lame in both feet. The next point I want to share with you guys is that the kindness of God is extravagant towards me because of who he is. It's extravagant toward me because of who he is. David restores Mephibosheth's stuff. He doesn't even do just that. I love that Ziba gets in the act, and Ziba's whole house is blessed, and he's allowed to come to the table. If it sounds a little familiar to you, maybe you might remember last year as we studied Psalm 23 that we see early in David's reign, he's practicing what we see later in Psalm 23. I love that when you look at this scripture, you start to see the reality that green pastures is where he's bringing Mephibosheth. But green pastures is not where he was at. He was in a desolate place. His goodness and his mercy is following him now for the rest of his life, because the king has restored his identity. I want to ask you a question. When's the last time you sat at the table of the king and you looked at your enemies and the king said, "Excuse me, you're going to have to wait. You can't touch them yet. We're having dinner." Because we're at the king's table. You're not just at any table. You've been restored to the king's table. When you're at the king's table, you don't worry about anything. You ask for what you want and it shows up. He's in a place of safety and security where just a few verses before, he was in desolation and a lack of hope. Harvest, I believe that the Lord Jesus wants us to know that his kindness is everlasting. His kindness is for us if we lower ourselves before him. And I don't know who's here under the sound of my voice, that you are here, you look good, and you're smiling, but the fact is, you're living figuratively in Lodabar. It's just dry. It's challenging. Job you find yourself in, maybe it's a family situation or your marriage. Maybe it's the state that we're in as a ministry in our church. You're just, Pastor Ed, if I'm going to be honest, like a woman in the last service that just came and wept, talked to me afterwards, I'm in Lodabar. In a few moments, I want to pray, because Lodabar is not your destiny. Lodabar is not where you're going to stay. But something happens in Lodabar that your character is transformed. Your perspective is shaped when you're in Lodabar. Because God's kindness does three things. One, God's kindness provides for no fear. There's no fear in this place. The second thing is God's kindness provides restoration. Restoration for your situation and the things that you're going through. He provides that in his kindness. But the last thing is, it provides a place at the table. And so it would be criminal for me to preach the word of God and to leave this place, us being tickled and touched, but not transformed. And so I want to ask you a question. And I'm not here to embarrass anyone. It's been a powerful week and weekend. But I believe that some of you are in Lodabar and you need our prayers today. And so if you're in a place in your life where you feel like you're in Lodabar, I'm not going to ask you to come up, but I want to ask you by a declaration of faith. I just want you to stand right where you are. If you feel like you're in Lodabar, just stand right now where you are. Thank you so much. Just stand all over the building. Thank you so much. Thank you. Just stand right where you are. Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. You know the thing I love about church? This is a place that you don't have to be plastic and phony. I'm so tired of fake friends. Just makes me think of Ariana Grande. Thank you, next. Thank you, next. We don't want fake friends. We want people who are real. And so in this moment, I thank you for your honesty. And here's the moment that's transformative in this service. I want people who love the Lord, who are around you, I just want them to stand and put their hands on you. Right now, wherever you're at, just go up. If there are people that are standing, just go ahead. Thank you. Just join in. We're family. This is what we do. Lay hands on them. And in a moment, I'm going to pray a prayer of faith. And I want you folks who are around them just to begin now. Begin praying for them and interceding for them. You don't even need to know their name. Just pray for them now in faith. By faith, pray for them. The kindness of God over their lives. The mercy of God over their lives. The goodness of God over their lives. Father, thank you so much for this day. Thank you for your word in 2 Samuel chapter 9. And I thank you for the people who are standing, who are in Lodabar. I thank you, God, that they're in Lodabar, but they're not going to stay in Lodabar, because their destiny is not Lodabar. Their destiny is Jerusalem. And so, God, we lift up right now by faith each of our brothers and sisters that are standing. We cancel the assignment of the enemy in their lives. We cast out every spirit that's not like you, Satan. You have no place in their lives. In Jesus' name, amen. Look at me right now, the people who are standing, look at me right now. God loves you. You're not alone. You see all of these people, they're not, you're not alone. So I want us to stand as we worship the Lord Jesus, declaring that his goodness and his mercy is with us.